In the spring of 1970, campus communities across this country were characterized by a chorus of protests and demonstrations. The issues were the escalation of the war in Vietnam and the U.S. invasion of Cambodia, the ecology, racism and repression, and the inclusion of the experiences of women and minorities in the educational system. No institution of higher education was left untouched by the confrontations and continuous calls for change. At Jackson State College in Jackson, Mississippi, there was the added issue of historical racial intimidation and harassment by white motorists along Lynch Street, a major thoroughfare that divided the campus and linked West Jackson to downtown.
Lynch Street, where I'm standing now, a popular thoroughfare for whites traveling in and out of the city. It could be said that years of confrontations between students and motorists driving down Lynch Street and the continued fight for civil rights were two integral factors that cultivated the atmosphere from which the Jackson State tragedy occurred.
Lynch Street, during that particular time and even before, was a thoroughfare for white people to get to and from their jobs to their homes. There was a red light at Alexander Hall and across, well, B.F. Roberts, right there. But cars used to come through there quite often. And the white citizens used to come through, and sometimes they would holler out or scream out obscenities and throw eggs and, you know, bottles and bricks or what have you. You know, using the N-word.
We were constantly subjected to racist taunts. The women were always shouted out, and some sexist remarks was made to them. And I think one of the speakers for this year's occasion, named Crockett, was hit by a car when she was crossing the streets here one time here at Jackson State. So, yeah, civil rights, this being Jackson, Mississippi, a lot of civil rights activities, the freedom rides, the arrest of a large amount of students. Megan Evers lived here. The COFO office, which was the spearhead of a lot of civil rights organizations, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, CORE, the Congress for Racial Equality, they all had hubs here in Jackson, Mississippi. So for sure, civil rights had to be a part of the equation that led up to the tragedy here in May of 1970.
On May 14th and 15th, 1970, Jackson State students were protesting these issues, as well as the May 4th, 1970 tragedy at Kent State University in Ohio. Four Kent State students were killed by Ohio National Guardsmen.
I came driving through here just checking things out. There were students all over the place down here on the corner in front of Alexander Hall. And all of a sudden they started throwing bricks and rocks through my windows. And broke the windows out in this Plymouth station wagon I was in, a marked WJTV news vehicle.
I saw this car coming through and some bottles and rocks were being thrown at the car.
It was a red light back there in that science building. And somebody hollered out, the child ever was shot, the civil rights icon of the state. And when they said that, that man pulled up at that red light, they said, that's what it is. Everybody started throwing bricks at it.
Okay, man, you know, let's everybody calm down and leave it alone. You know, let's stop. Went home, I stayed behind the campus on Morehouse and Cleveland Avenue in the apartments there. Came back that evening. There was another little incident. But everything settled down. Everything had settled down. That next night, it all started on the 14th, so the 15th, was when we heard the marching.
And we watched as they approached the campus and were marching as if they were marching to war. They were in lines. It appeared to be hundreds of them. I don't have a count, but as I go back, I know there was a lot of them. And we watched them from the window, and they marched down Lynch Street.
And as they, which direction did they come?
They came from the west, and they passed by the young men with the fire. And they came, continued till they got to the front of Alexander Hall. And we came across the hall and looked out of my dormitory room window.
It was the Highway Patrol and City Police. Everybody on both sides of the campus, they came up Lynch Street. I was at the fence on the south side of Lynch Street in front of B.F. Roberts Dining Hall, along with other friends of mine. And on the north side were students laying on the ground in front of Alexander Hall and just, you know, hanging out the windows.
But they marched on up in there, we're gonna kill some of you niggas.
These students, in my experience, for the first time in the civil rights movement, were really saying nasty things to the police officers. They were calling them pigs, telling them, get off the campus. You don't have any business here. We don't need you here. And they were doing it at close range. I'd never seen that happen at close range before. Usually, there was great distance between protesters and police officers. It'd usually be, you know, several hundred feet. But here they were, police officers right in the middle of this street, and the protesters right over there, and you could hear each other very well.
Accounts differ as to what happened. Some students say the police advanced in a line, warned them, then opened fire. Others said the police abruptly opened fire on the crowd. Police claimed they spotted a powder flare in the Alexander Hall west third floor stairwell window and opened fire in self-defense on the dormitory only. Two local television reporters present at the shooting did not agree that a shot was fired and were uncertain of the direction. A radio reporter claimed to have seen an arm and a pistol extending from a dormitory window.
The only communication I heard back from the police officers came from a highway patrolman who stepped up with a megaphone and said, ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention?
Please.
And it was right after that that the shooting started. Wow. The bottle broke in the middle of the police officers and they started firing.
By that time, one of the students threw a bottle and the bottle burst. All hell broke loose. Shooting.
Whatever actually happened, the police opened fire and continued firing for more than 30 seconds. The students scattered, some running for the trees in front of the library, but most scrambling for the Alexander Hall west end door.
And when they went to kneel, I dived under the trees that was on this side of West Hall. And they had me pinned down by the wall and I couldn't get up. And bullets was flying all over my head.
It was just like something out of a movie. When you're watching a war movie and you hear hundreds of guns shooting. And when we realized that we were being fired upon, we turned and fell to the floor. I remember feeling something hot hitting my back.
And when they shot, we pushed right through that door right there. And we went through that, you hear the bullets popping off the wall like firecrackers. And so I was just zigzagging like, if we were lucky, many of us didn't get killed. If I had to start down low, shooting low, I wouldn't have been here today to tell you about it. They would have gotten me.
And all you could hear was, oh, 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 oh. I was on the ground. And I kept seeing all this fire going over my head, and I kept pulling the grass so I could get where I needed to get.
There was screaming and cries of terror mingled with the noise of sustained gunfire as the students struggled en masse to get through the glass and double doors. A few students were trampled. Others, struck by buckshot or bullets, fell only to be dragged inside or left moaning in the grass.
Somebody howled out, stop firing, or hold your fire. And I got up and ran into the dormitory.
Having heard the shootings and smelling the gunfire and gun smoke in the air, you would have thought that more than two students had been killed. And it was a miracle that, tragically, it was just Philip Gibbs and James Green.
Philip Lafayette Gibbs, 21, a junior pre-law major and father of an 18-month-old son, lay dead 50 feet east of the west wing door of Alexander Hall.
Philip Gibbs was a junior political science major from Ripley, Mississippi, a new father, Philip Gibbs, a junior.
I knew Philip. I'd had classes with him.
Philip, that was my classmate. Double doors. Man. They lit him up in the back first. He was trying to get in. And when he turned around, he was like this. And they used M16s and 30-30s. Man, it was so, boom!
Right.
Took him through those doors.
Across the street, behind the line of police and highway patrolmen, 17-year-old James Earl Green was walking home from work at a local grocery store. Stopped by the action, Green was slammed in the right side of his chest by a single buckshot in front of B.F. Roberts Hall.
James Earl Green was a student at Jim Hill High School, a senior who had hopes of going to run track and participate in the upcoming Olympics. He was on his way home from a part-time job, and he was shot there on the other side of Lynch Street.
B.F. Roberts.
Okay, right.
That's where
right.
James Green was killed.
So. Right.
Right on the steps of B.F. Roberts. This young boy was just coming home from working at night. You know, he was a high school student at Jim Hill.
And he was trying to jump over the fence when the shooting started on this side because the highway patrolman was lined up facing this dormitory. So he was like in the back of them. So if you're lined up facing the dormitory, shooting up in the dormitory, why would you turn around and shoot somebody in the back of you? So it was really a racial thing, and anything black that moved, that was their mission to come out and kill.
Meanwhile, I heard this big fat highway patrolman, I assumed he was the leader. He got on his intercom and somebody said, well, I guess you'll need some ambulance. He said, yes, we'll need some ambulances. We got some niggas up here down.
And when I regained consciousness, I was in an ambulance on the way to Hines General Hospital. It's now Central Mississippi Medical Center. And I was in the ambulance with another young lady who had been injured.
Injured and carried to University Hospital for treatment were Fonzie Coleman, Tuwayne Davis, Clemmy Johnson, Leroy Kenter, Gloria Mayhorn, Andrea Reese, Patricia Ann Sanders, Stella Spinks, Lonzi Thompson, Vernon Steve Weekly, Red Wilson Jr., and Willie Woodard. Also injured and transported to other hospitals for treatment were Gladys Dickens Johnson and Galia Porter. To justify the shooting, officers claimed they saw a sniper somewhere between the third and fifth floor of Alexander Hall. Former WJTV reporter Bert Case witnessed the incident and disputed claims of a sniper.
I've been quoted as saying, that I saw a sniper. I've never said that. I never did see a sniper. Now, I did say this in the aftermath. We had a tape recorder on my side, one of these little cheap cassette tape recorders, and it was rolling the whole time. And right prior to the shooting beginning, you can hear the bottle break very clearly, and then there's pop, pop, boom, 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 boom. 29.2 seconds, they went. Now, Jack Hobbs, who was standing beside me and shooting for me, shooting video, shooting 16-millimeter film, and I listened to that tape many times, and we wondered about those two pop pops. We thought at one time that it might have been gunshots, the pop pop on the tape. Well, I since know that that's been analyzed by the best acoustical experts this country has. The FBI took that tape to Washington and analyzed it, and they said you could not conclude from those sounds that it was gunfire. It could very well have been the microphone being knocked up against the tape recorder while it was rolling, while I moved. But I did say at one time, you know, we thought we heard two shots on tape, but we weren't sure. I sure never knew where they came from. I never saw a sniper. I never heard a sniper. I don't believe there was a sniper. I think the whole thing was triggered by that wine bottle hitting right in the middle of the patrolman and shattering and hitting a bunch of them. It hit me too. I got a piece of the glass from that bottle hitting my leg. And I think that startled them, and they were so on edge, and they started shooting. I think that's exactly what happened.
It was never a sniper in the girls' west wing of the dormitory. And I would go to my grave on that one, saying that there was never a man in that room, in that building, breaking one and shooting at the police officer. Crazy.
First of all, if it was a sniper on the fifth floor, why are you shooting on the other side of the campus then? Why aren't you shooting? You never would have hit any of the students laying down on the ground. Mm-hmm. If you knew that was a sniper on the fifth floor, then you had to see him. Secondly, most importantly, is this. No male could go past the water fountain anyway at Alexander Hall. And I know this for a fact, and everybody else knows. Not during that period of time. You go to the water fountain, you have to ask to go, you had to ask to go to the water fountain to get you some water. So no sniper was on the fifth floor. And here again, let's think logically. If there were a sniper on the fifth floor, you would not have hit all of these students on both sides of the campus of Lynch Street. No way. You're trained.
I don't think there's any way you can justify firing 460 shots at a girl's dormitory for 29 and a half seconds. I don't see anything that justifies that. Dr. Peoples told me earlier today that what it amounted to was young black people like were out here that night in 1970. We're not accustomed to taking anything from law enforcement officers. They were young and different than the older days. That they were not afraid of law enforcement officers, not afraid to call them a pig and to shout insults at them. And those law enforcement officers out here had never heard that from black people at close range, and they were all white. Dr. Peoples is of the belief that that's what caused what happened out here, is that the white officers were just not accustomed to what happened. And in his word, as he described it to me today, it was a police riot.
Mississippi has always been a state that was very overt when it came to blacks and whites. Certain things you can't prove because certain things are hidden. I think it had to do with who the individuals were, meaning black students, also meaning that it was a black institution, also meaning that it was in a black neighborhood, also meaning that the retaliation of what had transpired that day and the day before, white folks, white motorists, throwing bottles, hollering out obscenities, the N-word, and eggs over the years and during that period of time had a lot to do with it. It was racial, in my opinion.
It was the temper of the times, and looking back in retrospect, knowing what they did at Kent State University to white students, the atmosphere in this country was against student protesters, and every campus in this country was in an uproar. So here was an opportunity for Mississippi law enforcement officials, and we know the reputation that Mississippi law enforcement has, especially when it comes to dealing with black people, and they had an opportunity to shoot up in a women's dormitory with students in front of it, and not caring about the loss of lives.
I really want to know, why did no one else do anything for these students who were hurt and pain?
I think at that particular time, a lot of people wanted to do something, but we were all traumatized. We really didn't know what to do at that particular time. Some of us stayed around in the community and tried to encourage people to come out and support us, to bring attention to what had happened, because again, this is just 2 weeks after the killing of four students, Allison Krauss, Sandra Shure, Jeffrey Glenn Miller, and William Schrader at Kent State University in Ohio. And this is being Mississippi. A lot of people may not have taken it as seriously because these were black students on a black campus in Mississippi versus white students on a predominantly white campus in Ohio. Some students from Tougaloo and Millsaps College did walk out in protest, and one of the stories that's very seldom told is that high school students here in Jackson, at Brinkley, Jim Hill, and Lindia, walked out, and they closed the schools down and brought attention to it. In fact, the schools were shut down until after the funerals of Philip Gibbs and James Green. So one of the stories and one of the acts of appreciation that's never acknowledged is what young high school students did here in Jackson, Mississippi.
The media coverage of this was very poor. it made national news. NBC, CBS were both in here the next morning, and I was working for the CBS affiliate at the time. CBS used our coverage of it and did their own. So did NBC. I don't recall ABC being here, but I feel sure they were. But it got nowhere near the coverage of Kent State, for example. Kent State was a much larger story than Jackson State was, and I never understood that. Because
you think this was purely a racist conflict?
You've got to ask that question. You got to wonder about that, that Kent State got all the attention it did, and it was a predominantly white school, and here Jackson State didn't get nearly the attention Kent State did, and it's a predominantly black school. It's got to make you wonder.
The next day, May 16, 1970, Dr. Peoples ended the semester and asked students to leave the campus. The class of 1970 never held a graduation ceremony. In the weeks, months, and years that followed, several legal actions were taken on behalf of the victims, but neither a grand jury nor a civil jury indicted any officers.
Today, 42 years later, no apologies, no accountability, no closure, and no justice for the Gibbs Green tragedy.
The eyes and ears of these victims and witnesses make it profoundly clear that the memories of May 14th and 15th will always live on.